On one hand, there was a strong body of UK jurisprudence, House of Lords cases, CASI in particular, which said that the legislation was compatible with the convention and there was no need to consider the proportionality of the eviction notice. But in the meantime, the Strasbourg Court had very firmly rejected the British position in two cases in particular. Connors in the UK, a case you may be aware of, is about travellers who'd been served with eviction notices from their halting site. And again, under the same legislation, they were told that the proportionality of that eviction notice wasn't something the court had to consider. Article 8 didn't apply, that was rejected at Strasbourg. Similarly, in K in the UK, somebody with a non-secure tenancy argued that Article 8 required the courts to consider the proportionality of the eviction notice. Strasbourg agreed. So, on one view, the British case isn't very interesting because they had very little choice. They were told by Strasbourg what to do. There was one interesting point, though, where Lord Hope said, even though Strasbourg has given us a steer, we're not bound by Strasbourg. And this is the Ulla principle that Fiona mentioned. This might be something, again, the Irish courts are interested in, because national courts here and in England aren't bound by the Strasbourg cases. They have regard to them. And the Supreme Court in Britain, and particularly in view of Lord Hoffman's recent comments, is still on the fence. They are stressing increasingly the fact that they can differ from the Strasbourg Court, because it's not sometimes clear to see whether they're doing more or less. It's easy to have the other catchphrase, maybe more, never less. That sometimes is a too glib statement. The Supreme Court now is saying there's a very clear line of case law in Strasbourg, we're very likely to follow it. But if there isn't, we may well do our own thing, regardless of what the Strasbourg Court has said, even very recently. But in this case, they follow the Strasbourg Court, and they said that Article 8 did apply. They made the point clearly, though, that this applied only to local authorities. They said they weren't making any finding in relation to whether Article 8 and a proportionality test was required where a private, where an eviction notice was served in a private context, whether by a landlord or through the operation of the mortgage rules. And although they did recognise the necessity of an Article 8 analysis and proportionality analysis, they threw several significant caveats into the mix. So again, they give with one hand but take with the other. They said that they would expect it would be almost impossible to challenge the legitimacy of the objective. All a local authority had to do was say, we need the house back for the purposes of our statutory functions. It wouldn't be necessary for them to put in much evidence. And they, a tenant could only show that the eviction notice is disproportionate in exceptional circumstances. Which struck me, I have to say, as a rather odd thing to say, because they can't anticipate in advance what local authority tenants may raise. But on balance, once the Supreme Court opened the door to a proportionality analysis, as we all know as practitioners, that will allow facts of difficult cases to be properly adjudicated. And although the Supreme Court has been strict in its approach, the reality, I think, now is the opportunity for injustice has been significantly reduced in these cases. In Ireland, there is obvious significance in the ongoing case of Colette Heffernan and the Attorney General in Ireland. I mean, again, you will know far better than I, because although I've been in practice in the UK for over 10 years, I've only been a barrister here for about a year. So these cases I've heard about from colleagues, and I have no personal knowledge of them myself. But I understand that the state's mortgage law and practice is being challenged on the same basis, and a declaration of incompatibility is being sought here on exactly the same basis that under the current Irish rules in Anglo-Irish Bank and Fanning, once possession order is served and the rules are properly followed, the court isn't required to examine the proportionality of the eviction notice. I should note, though, in passing, that PINOC has been applied and extended even to insecure tenancies in the case of Hounslow and Powell. This is a case from 2011. In that case, the Supreme Court looked at people whose hold on their homes was even looser than in the PINOC case. The London Borough of Hounslow against Powell case involved two types of insecure tenancy. First was for homeless people. The way it works under the Housing Act is a homeless person is given a home, but they can be evicted on almost no notice at all. Their position is insecure. And there's a kind of a second stage of insecure tenancy, called a probationary tenancy, where someone can be given a year-long probationary period before they're allowed to have a secure tenancy. The reason for this is that, in terms of the legitimate interest, is that certain types of people come and go very easily, and the local authorities need the property back. The property's vacated, or for whatever reason, the person won't comply with the conditions for residence. It becomes necessary to give the property to a more deserving or more needy person. Parliament in the UK has legislated very clearly to create a distinction between secure and insecure tenancies. Hounslow and Powell said, the Supreme Court said, that notwithstanding this distinction, Article 8 still applied, it was still necessary for each and every eviction notice to test the proportionality of that measure. But again, lots of caveats. They said they would expect very little need for justification from the local authority, and a success in the part of the claimants or plaintiffs in exceptional cases only. So, moving on to another aspect of Article 8, and privacy rights. And again, I'd be interested to hear in the Q&A session the extent to which any of this is relevant in Irish law. From my own study of Irish law and my analysis of the Irish cases, it struck me that many of the questions which the English courts have been addressing under Article 10 of the Convention are questions which the Irish courts had already addressed, sometimes with different results, under the Irish Constitution. And so again, although I will hopefully interest you in some of this Article 8 and Article 10 analysis, I would be interested to hear from practitioners the extent to which any of this is of any use in day-to-day litigation, or whether these remedies and procedures are already fully canvassed under the existing rules. But this is something which is topical both here and in the UK. Again, it demonstrates how the Human Rights Act and the Convention is necessary to protect not those of us who are in the mainstream and who have perhaps the respect and understanding of our peers. Lord Bingham wrote a very interesting, the late, great president of the Supreme Court and former law lord, said that the Convention is of little use to most people who have jobs and who are in the mainstream of British life, who are white, who feel that they belong, and who are respected by their peers. The Convention is of greatest assistance to the people who are at the margins in every sense, people who attract hatred and fear. And in particular, in these two cases, the people who benefited, who were assisted by this, were potential child sex offenders. There's been quite a lot of recent legislation in the UK designed to target these individuals to protect the community, which is obviously a very legitimate aim, but in a number of respects, the courts have found the legislation has gone too far in violating those individuals' Article 8 rights. The first case is called R.F. Litigation Friend against the Secretary of State of the Home Department, 2010. This was a case where a sex offender had been, it was a rule, a legal rule in England, that anyone who has been sentenced for more than 30 months for a sex offence, a child-related sex offence, is subject to a lifelong obligation to notify the police of their whereabouts and their travel plans. And under the particular statutory rule, that was without any review procedure. That was a lifelong requirement and no opportunity for review. The proportionality of that was challenged, and the Supreme Court analysed it in great detail. Again, interesting for practitioners, what Lord Phillips, the current president of the Supreme Court, did was engage in a very close factual analysis of the proportionality of the measure. He looked at whether child sex offenders were likely to reoffend. He looked at the statistics, because if, for example, as a matter of fact, the risk of reoffending was enormous, it might have been easier for the state to show that a review mechanism would have been pointless. So he engaged in a very close factual analysis, which is unusual in a top Supreme Court. But of course, since the misbehaving case and the Denby case in the UK, the rule is the proportionality of a measure under the Human Rights Act is tested as at the time of the court's hearing. So they don't look at the facts that were before the decision maker, they look at the facts as they stand at the date of the hearing. So you have a much more intense factual analysis, and the court will look at material which was not and maybe could not have been before the decision maker at the time of the decision.